Moss. I am the morning on-air personality for Rhythm and Praise. It's a gospel radio station here in town. And happy to be with you guys tonight. Welcome to the 11th Soup Event. This started in 2017. And it really started from two people tossing around ideas. And it is what you see it today. It's an organization that has awarded almost $14,000 to projects and programs in the community. Go ahead and give yourself a little pat on the back, because we wouldn't be able to do this without you guys. So thank you guys for being here tonight. And of course, we got to thank our sponsors, Parkview, YLNI, our partners Fort Wayne, Confluence, who met with our presenters. They helped them do their message tonight, and wouldn't be possible without them. So we're going to get this thing started tonight. So this is how it's going to go down, okay? I don't like being all formal. I like having fun. So let's have fun tonight. So this is how it's going to go. We are going to have five presenters. Everybody say five.
Five.
Okay. And they're going to talk for four minutes. Ooh, who's been here? Show of hands who's been here. Oh, you guys are like, oh, the new girl's here. She's trying to tell us what to do. Okay. So for 4 minutes, and then after the 4 minutes, we're going to have a Q&A session of how long?
Four minutes.
So they're going to present for 4 minutes. Then we're going to have a Q&A session. You guys can ask questions for 4 minutes. And at the end of the presentations, you guys are going to be able to cast your vote for the best presenter. And we've got some really good presenters in the house tonight. So excited. And the presenter, the best presenter with the most votes, is going to receive the door money. And they're going to also receive the matching sponsorship of dollars that you guys paid money for when you came in. So the money you guys got, then the matching sponsorship. So we're going to get started with our first presenter. Ann Clark, if you want to make your way up to the stage from Downtown Express. She was raised in Fort Wayne. She's a former secondary social studies and English teacher with Fort Wayne Community Schools. And she is going to talk about tonight the electric shuttle service that provides a micro transit solution for downtown Fort Wayne. Everybody give it up for Ann Clark.
Provide. Now, according to a 2016 downtown blueprint plan, that we tried to make, one of the goals was to make Fort Wayne downtown more easily accessible to people that are pedestrians, motorists, and people on bicycles. Well, it takes about anywhere from 6 minutes to 21 minutes to walk from point A to point B, depending on where you're at downtown. So, here's the problem. If you're in a wheelchair, if you're disabled, if you're pregnant, if you've got small children, if you're elderly, you need another form of microtransit solution to get you from point A to point B, and that's what the Downtown Express is designed to do. Now, it can be for anybody, because I haven't pedaled anything since I've been 16, and I don't intend to start right now. Okay, so just saying, all right? So how are we going to go about doing that? Well, we're going to connect people from point A to point B. We're going to go green, meaning that it's all electric, and we're also going to be able to reduce congestion by enabling you to park once and be able to shuttle from point A to point B, as well as it's free. Free for the ride. Now you're probably saying, well, wait, how's it free? Well, the Downtown Express is going to use a free, green, and safe shuttle service that utilizes a six-passenger, all-electric, street-legal, customized golf cart that's advertiser-driven. And what I mean by that is our goal is to partner with the city of Fort Wayne for a pilot project next summer, starting in June, running through August 2020, in which we'll be able, through the city, be able to also access some grant money, but also be able to provide fixed routes, say from Monday through Friday from 11 to 2 during peak lunch hours, as well as what we call mobility on demand, which will be Thursday, Friday, and Saturday from say 9 to 1 o'clock in the morning, in which we'll be driving around and just hail us down. Now, the free comes in because we're going to be, like I said, advertiser driven. We're going to get corporate sponsorships in which the ad will generate revenue, which will wrap the shuttles with advertisement around the shuttle. We'll also have a topside billboard and also onboard electronic advertising. win-win situation for not only the city, because all of our drivers will be brand ambassadors that will be able to promote downtown events from point A to point B for visitors and tourists alike. Win-win for businesses, because we're going to promote you as a business with all the advertisement that's going to be on the outside, inside, and on top of our vehicles. And a win-win situation for the rider, because it's going to be for free. You don't have to pay anything. We highly suggest you tipping your driver, but other than that, it's free. And so for those destinations that are just a little too long to walk, but yet short enough to not justify paying for a ride hailing service, just remember, the Downtown Express will get you from point A to point B, and remember, it's going to be a totally free
ride.
Thank you.
I'm going to be saying free ride all night today. Yeah, we're going to go ahead and start our time of Q&A. So we have 4 minutes, and he's going to start the clock, and you guys can go ahead and start asking questions.
How many vehicles do you plan to start with, and do you have a number that you want to grow to?
I'd like to start with 4, if it's possible, because I really need to make one of them ADA accessible, because that's part of my demographic. And by doing that, I've got to take out a row of seats. So 3, hopefully 4, if I can get the funding for it.
Will it have, besides point A to point B, if a passenger wants to get off at A and a half, can they do that?
Absolutely. That's part of what we call mobility on demand. It's the fixed route, I believe, was worked best during lunch hours to promote the businesses. If you're working, especially if you're working, and I used to work downtown at the gas house, so I know how many people would have to come and drive. This would alleviate that. We would have fixed route. But all the other times, and even during other major events, say Three Rivers Festival, we'll be going around the entire time downtown.
Are there a set of hours that you'll be in operation, weekends, nights?
I'd like to start, like I said, I'd like to do the fixed route starting Monday through Friday from 11 to 2. And then what I was looking at, the demographics, and I was looking at the different surveys that I looked at the research, that the most people are down Thursday, Friday, and Saturday nights, the young people are downtown. Now, this is for anybody. It doesn't have to be young. It could be anybody. But it'll be the mobility, what we call mobility on demand, on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday evenings. And then during major events like Three Rivers, we'll be out in force. Okay.
I think you may have answered the question, but will you have pickup and drop-off points like the city bus does? There's a lot of congestion downtown.
Yeah, right. Well, I plan to have both fixed routes. Like I said, that would be during lunch during 11 to 2. I think like they tried the trolley last summer, I don't know if anybody during Three Rivers event, and I wrote on that, where they were able to, that people that work downtown to be able to get to Junk Food Alley, they had fixed destinations and they had 2 great big trolleys. These are smaller because they're street legal and you can only have 3,000 pounds, so I can only have 5 people in these things, okay? And I want it to be electric because I want to reduce our carbon emissions on the road for the environment. So at that particular point in time, there'll be fixed route. Now, if it warrants that it maybe works out better to have fixed routes, we can do that. But I'm looking at the possibility of doing both.
Okay, one question. How do you contact or flag this service? Is it you stand out
well,
on the corner? Is there an app?
Well, that's a good question. Right now, I'm in the process of working with my next door neighbor who's a junior in high school who is a computer extraordinaire, okay? And he's Garrett, and he's going, oh, no problem, I can make this app for you. So I'm going to take his word for it right now and utilize that. But yes, both app and also ride hailing where you can flag me down, both.
Are you aware of any other communities who had this model and has it been successful?
Yes, absolutely. Greenville, South Carolina would be the same metropolitan area as Fort Wayne. As a matter of fact, we went to them when we did our downtown study. But also, Charlotte, North Carolina, Cincinnati, Ohio, Columbus, Ohio, Denver, Colorado, all over Florida, and mostly because they alleviate congestion from these places. Most of them operate, they're in a better climate, they can operate year-round, where mine, of course, is going to be only seasonal. I can see that, but yes, they're everywhere and they're having a great success. The biggest one is called Circuit, and they're the ones that started this in the Hamptons and went through Florida.
All right, give it up for Ian Clark from Downtown Express. All right, our second presenter of the night is David Buck. He's from House Bill for Cass Housing. He was born and raised here in Fort Wayne in the Summit City. He and his wife lived in a residential community for adults with intellectual disabilities while he earned his master's in human services. In 2015, he started Cass Housing. It's a nonprofit organization which partners with families to create customized long-term housing support solutions and with people with disabilities. Welcome to the stage, David Buck.
So I came across this quote earlier this week, and I absolutely loved it. And if you need the best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. The second best time to plant a tree is today. Right. So we're going to come back to that concept in a little bit. So who here knows somebody with autism, Down syndrome, traumatic brain injury, something like that? Perfect. So if you look around real quick. So for the last decade, I've had the opportunity to meet hundreds of families and partner alongside of them. And I've worked with folks with severe autism that were nonverbal that really taught me what love truly looks like. I've also had the opportunity to work with folks to transition them into their dream independent living house, right? So there's this, to kind of understand, or the regardless of ability level, socioeconomic status, there's one common issue that unites all these families. And that question is, what's gonna happen to my child when I can no longer take care of them or when I pass away? And to understand kind of what these families go through, you need a little bit of history. So in 2012, the state of Indiana changed how they do funding for folks with developmental disabilities. Before you get on a waiting list, most families would wait about 10 years. During that time, you receive no supports. But once your child's name is pulled, they have the funding to move into what's called a Medicaid waiver home. That whole system changed 7 years ago. So now the waiting list is between 8 and 16 months, which sounds much more reasonable. It's a smaller block grant of funding to help pay for earlier therapies, help in the home, that kind of thing. You need this larger block grant to move into a 24/7 residential setting. So the question is how do you move from the smaller setting to the larger setting? Both biological parents have to turn 80, both parents have to die, or the child has to have significant medical or behavioral issues, and I had a gentleman bite through his mother's arm that was not deemed significant enough. So in Indiana today, if you've got a child with autism, Down syndrome, traumatic brain injury, anything like that, they're living at home until parents are 80 years old or dead, for the vast majority of folks. And so there's this massive need. And so in 2015, I ended up leaving my job to start what would become Cass Housing. Cass is a privately funded nonprofit organization that creates customized housing support plans for folks with intellectual disabilities. We're 100% privately funded. We actually just opened our first home back in January. And CAS stands for Customizable, Affordable, Sustainable, and Safe, kind of the key tenets that families are looking for and needing out of a long-term solution. So where are we at right now? So we're actually getting ready, we're prepping to begin work on our second house, but where do you guys come in? So we've got an interest list of nearing 200 people right here in our community that are interested in a CAS house. One of the biggest hurdles that families are facing is 80% of those families can't identify a housemate. And so it's matchmaking, it's connecting people around common interests, hobbies, backgrounds, things like that. And so to kind of come back to that quote, when's the best time to plant a tree? 20 years ago. When's the best time to develop lifelong friendships? 20 years ago. And if you haven't developed those lifelong friendships, today's a great time to start it. So what we're looking to use the soup funding for is really continue to expand our programming and to be able to continue to connect families and other core members to result in potential housemates to open up additional homes. Thank you so much.
All right, we'll now enter time questions for David.
Just curious, is there an age limit or basically a minimum age that they have to be?
So we're looking at adults, so okay. 18 and over.
Okay. Is there any sort of minimum requirements as far as
capability or independence?
Yeah, so we've got three different models of support. So an independent living model for folks that are able to live independently. Family living is for people that would benefit more from a family environment. And then Family Plus is for folks that need 24-hour support. So we're starting in the independent living model as just kind of work out the kinks, but you know the goal is to work down those other models.
So you, over here, you launched the first one in January. How has that been going so far?
Yeah, so my wife and I have actually, we're the live-in stewards for the first house, so we have all kinds of fun stories of what the last 8 months have been. You know, probably the best story was a couple, probably a month ago. It was about 11 o'clock, and I went over to, I needed to talk to one of the guys, and so I texted him, and he said he was still awake, and so there's a commons area where the guys can hang out. And so one guy was, they're watching Home Improvement. The one guy was sleeping with his phone on his chest, and the other guy was in the recliner just getting ready to fall asleep. You know, and I thought, you know, where are these guys at a year ago, right? You know, they're in their bedroom, lights are off, they're on their phone, whatever, and now they've got the opportunity to have this friendship, to be able to do what they want to do, and it's just been absolutely fantastic. So, one of many stories. The other ones include farts, but that's the
hello there. Well, my question is, what is there two or three families typically to a house, and what happens if after a year or two it doesn't work and a family member needs to move out?
Right, so one of the biggest, so we're looking at three core members per house, regardless of the models, and that's one of the reasons why we don't want to just do random placement, is really developing those friendships and those relationships kind of on the front end. If a person does need to move out, we would be going to the other two families to kind of work through those details of bringing somebody else in. So it's not, you know, it's a part of a person's journey. It's not the end of a person's journey, right? It's still staying involved in different programs and still getting to know either more folks if something like that would need to happen.
So how do you go about determining whether these folks are compatible or not?
Yeah.
Is this like a dating app? I mean, are they swiping left? Swiping right,
yeah.
You know, are they getting to, you know, speed date at some point,
yeah,
or another, or, you
so
know,
really
on
the
profile?
The main goal is to kind of tap into their already established social networks. So like for our first guys, they actually all knew each other through a basketball league. They were not best friends by any means, but they knew each other, right? And so what we're kind of doing is going back to the families to say, what are things that you're already involved in? Is it Special Olympics? Is it your church groups? Is it day programs, things like that? And just kind of changing the mindset of, you know, a lot of these things are kind of drop-off programs, and it's like, no, you need to be involved in talking to other folks. And if we're going to launch these homes, it's not just a life change for your child, it's a life change for the entire family, and we're creating teams of people, right? So, yeah, so it's not, we're not just randomly putting people together, it's, we're kind of creating the environment for cultivation to happen.
What kind of qualifications do you have for the people that would be taking care of these people have,
yep,
with such a,
yep,
broad spectrum?
So I've got 6 seconds. So the key thing is that the folks are actually chosen by the families and the core members themselves. So that's kind of the first basis, because we don't want just anybody stepping into that role. So there are people who are hardwired as caregivers, and this is kind of an opportunity, a new career path for those folks.
Okay, I was going to come in with give it up for David Buck of Cass Housing. Oh, I feel like we all just need to go like, whew, that's a lot of information in one night. Hold on, let me get my presidential back on. There we go.
Okay, our third guest of the night is Kelly Mervin. If you want to make your way to the stage, from Nutrition Coloring Book, a natural health practitioner. Integrative nutritionist, and she helps her clients guide to eat whole foods, cook simply, engage in regular self-care with hands-on cooking classes, personalized coaching programs, and informative speaking events. I might need this. Kelly Mervin, Nutrition Coloring Book. Come on up.
The way our children look at food. The idea that I have to present to you tonight is simple, it's engaging, and it is unforgettable. I'd like to tell you a little bit about me. In my past, I've had a lot of my own health issues. I've suffered through chronic disease, but most of all, I think I've suffered from a dangerous misconception centered around what food is. So my solution is to address this. I used to think that I was like savvy. You know, I paid attention to things, right? I have like Diet Coke, and I have like the Pop-Tarts with the real strawberries in it, because I thought I was doing pretty good, right? But I was suffering, and I was tired, and I was in a lot of pain. And when I started to understand that food had the ability to help me out of this, everything changed. And I asked myself, what is food? Food is actually the raw material that our body uses that enhances our emotions, that really ultimately determines our potential and the potential of our children. But do we even understand what real food is when we look at it? My proposal is very simple, but I think it's powerful. It's the idea of a coloring book. It's a coloring book that you would sit down and that you could visualize what that piece of food really is. So let's take an apple, for example. So what is an apple? We know apple has vitamin C, right? What's vitamin C good for? Do we know what vitamin C is good for? It's good for a cold, right? It's good for our immune system. So we've got a good start on understanding how food can help us. But when we walk into that grocery store, we may not see that and think, oh, maybe this is gonna help my cold, right? So we have suffered so many repercussions by not understanding what food is, by having deficiencies. And some of those can result in anything from bad skin to a headache to even death. People have died from deficiencies in their diet, not knowing. Mothers have lost children, not having the vitamins that they need in their diet. Great athletes have died from deficiencies in selenium. These all come from whole fruits and vegetables. So my coloring book is going to attach the left brain and the right brain. We're going to be using color. Color, we know, is attached to memory. That's why if you picture yourself out in the woods and you picture those blueberries, you are drawn to those blueberries naturally, right? Because they have that color. We are drawn to them because we want to find them later. It's our natural instinct. It's scientifically proven. So let's use the education, the science background that we have, and let's teach our children the real meaning of food with our coloring book. I have a little time, don't I? Okay, so supplementation, you might say, why not supplementation? I'll tell you why. Because it's not a whole real food, and a whole real food is a beautiful thing. It works synergetically. It is complex. It is made for our bodies. It's beautiful. And if we teach our children how to access real food to address their own health, think of what we can do in our community. Think of coming home and finding your kid eating more spinach because he knows that it has iron in it. Because he just colored that picture, and he knows what iron does, and he understands when he looks at that spinach or he looks at that apple what that food really does for his body.
Kelly Marvin. Any questions you guys have for Kelly?
Color and food to distinguish and differentiate whole food from, say, processed food or fast food so that our kids learn early and retain it long term?
Yeah, that's a great question. So we've really, marketing has really skewed our ideas, right? So this is going to be something so visual. I will dare you to color a picture of an apple with all of its vitamins and all of its brilliant colors and not walk in and recognize what is in that apple. I'd also like to have an illustration that may represent the opposite. I don't want to influence the negative a lot, but let's take a burrito. Let's take that Diet Coke. Let's talk about what's really in it and how it's serving your body. So there will be a part of comparison there.
Hi, Kelly. One question.
adult coloring books are so popular right now, is, are you planning this target for children or for adults and just kids at heart?
That's a beautiful question. I love it. I think it's so important to reach our children right now because, you know, this becomes ingrained in us, isn't it? I mean, when we're tired, we're like, oh, let's have coffee. I mean, we become ingrained. So I think that it's really important to start with our children and our community. But even as a nutritionist, with my experience, I'm going to learn something when I sit down with this book and I put pen to paper and I see those colors, it's going to imprint on my memory. So it's for everyone.
Can you think of different organizations in our community that you could use this with?
Yes, actually I can. So I, there are so many organizations. I just finished up doing some great cooking classes with the HEAL program. There are the Boys and Girls Club. There are just so many different areas that we can reach where we can have an activity that is fun, that is creative, that gets us involved, that you cannot get out of your head once you color it. So I think that there are so many possibilities in our community.
Yes, you did.
Oh, you want to say it loud? Am I supposed to?
We just need a microphone.
Where can you buy them?
The next question is right there. Then we'll come to you after. Okay.
Sure,
so we're
sure, sorry.
So I understand, like, coloring books and everything, and the creativeness, and it will really help children out as they're younger, and this will be ingrained into their brains and everything. But what about for growing teenagers and adults who are having eating problems as well?
Yeah, I think that will help so much. You know, what's happened to us, I think our senses have been robbed a little bit. So we think because it's really pretty or because it smells good or, you know, we're not looking at those right factors. So even as an adult, I understand now if I need more magnesium, oh my gosh, you know, I've got cramps, I've got these different problems. I'm going to find that in kale, for example. So absolutely, there's no age that this cannot help with. Yes.
So whenever you're coloring it, do you use different colors for each vitamin?
Yes, exactly. So in the beginning, there's going to be an index. We're going to have vitamin A, for example. Vitamin A is going to be orange on every single vegetable. You're going to know not only that vitamin A is orange, you're going to know what percentage of that particular vegetable is vitamin C and why I need it. So you might even look at the index and look at some of those symptoms and say, you know, I've got a headache today. I'm not sleeping very well today. What do I need to get into my diet and how do I find it?
All right. Give it up for Kelly Murphy from the All right, I would like to introduce our fourth presenter to the stage tonight, Rowan Green from Loaves and Fishes. He grew up in Fort Wayne and came back for adventure and travel to be a change maker in the local food economy. He is the founder of Plowshares Food Hub, a local farm product in, aggregation, inspection, and distribution here in Fort Wayne. Give it up for Rowan with Loaves and Fishes.
Organizations that have showed up to participate in this process. I want to say thank you to the Plowshares team for the work that they're doing with us, and also thank you to Healthier Moms and Babies, and also thank you to Lifeline. So I think we're all here for the same reasons, because we love Northeast Indiana, and we want a healthier future for our families for generations to come. So what I want to share with you this evening is about a community issue that's not easy to talk about lightly, and even harder to resolve. Indiana is number one in the states for infant mortality. Allen County is number one in Indiana. 17% of our population is fighting poverty, and 15% find it hard to source where their next food meal is coming from. That's a little less, that's a little more than 50,000 people. 20,000 of them are children. Studies show that a majority of brain development happens before the age of 7, and is directly correlated to the amount of nutrient-dense food that is consumed. So I propose a path forward from this bleak spot. The Loaves and Fishes Food Security Project is an initiative that pools funds from philanthropic businesses, organizations, and individuals to get healthy, nutrient-dense food in the hands of our hungry. Northeast Indiana has many amazing service organizations that impact the lives of the people they serve every day. The Loaves and Fishes Food Security Initiative is a tool that will allow them to amplify the impact they have on the people that they serve. How does it work? Plowshares Food Hub has partnered to give us vouchers and to distribute top quality local food, vegetables, meats, dairy, eggs, grains, noodles, directly to service affiliate agencies. And the affiliate agencies then give those vouchers to the people that they serve. For example, Healthier Moms and Babies has signed on as one of our first affiliate organizations, and we're going to partner with them to help combat infant mortality. The way that this manifests is by the nurses that work for Healthier Moms and Babies, when they go to the home of some of the at-risk families, they can see that those pregnant mothers that are expecting don't have the nutrient-dense food they need in order to bring to term the children with the highest capacity they can have. This program will allow those nurses to give that family a voucher that's good for locally produced nutrient-dense foods. Everything for our project is set to go. The project's set to fly. All we need now is the funding to get it off the ground. With the money that we get this evening, we'll be able to make 400 deliveries directly to the homes of these at-risk families. So please, vote for Loaves and Fishes. Vote for at-risk families to get the nutrient-dense food they need to develop to their highest potentials. Thank you.
Rowan Green from Loaves and Fishes will now enter a time of questions, whatever questions you guys have for Rowan, and we'll go off of who has the mic for questions.
Tell me how the program you're proposing is different from what already exists through both the WIC, the SNAP, and the food bank processes that are already happening in the city.
Absolutely. So all of those initiatives, or most of those initiatives, save the food banks that you just mentioned, are public sector initiatives and have a lot of bureaucracy in order to get approved for them. Ours is completely funded by private sector and individuals, so it can be less than 24 hours between when the at-risk family is identified and when the food can be in their hands.
So starting off, how many families can you service, and what do you expect that growth to be given the numbers that you gave us?
So Healthier Moms and Babies is the first affiliate organization that is got us a number of how many constituents they would like to serve monthly, and that number is 200 families. So if with funding just through that one agency, we could be impacting 200 families' lives, and more to come as more agencies sign on.
Can you give me an example of the type of delivery you would make, like what kind of food would be in there?
Absolutely. So currently, we're doing a seasonal bag program. The seasonal bag always has 6 ears of corn, a pound of potatoes, a pound of maybe carrots, squash, apples, peaches, whatever is really in season. But also, if the family wants to have more in-depth meal planning and be intentional with where they're spending their money, there's an entire catalog on the internet that they can order from.
Farmers have to go to get involved in this program.
What was the second half of that question?
What do farmers have to do if we have like local farmers who want to get involved? How do they get involved with your program?
So excellent question. All of the food that goes through this program comes from local farmers. So any money that gets donated ends up in the pocket of a Hoosier grower. And what farmers need to do in order to get involved is sign up through Plowshares Food Hub, because they're handling all of our aggregation and distribution.
You mentioned Northeast Indiana, so I'm curious, is this specific to Allen County? Is this like more of a regional project outside of Allen County, neighboring counties, or what's your region?
Well, right now, all of the agencies that have signed on, BNAACP, the Urban League, Healthier Moms and Babies, are all located here in Fort Wayne. But we have a potential partner that has a greenhouse in Anderson, so I expect growth.
So what's your differentiation between you and what Community Harvest Food Bank does?
Community Harvest accepts donations. They buy some food, but all of the food that we run through our service will guarantee that the farmers that grew it got paid a wage that makes it worthwhile for them to continue to provide us the nutrient-dense food that we all love. Thank you all.
We got Rowan Green with Loaves and Fishes. Our last presenter of the night is Judith DeLore. She is with the Priscilla Project. This is really impressive. She was adopted at the age of 3, grew up in Indy, where I am from, and she raised 5 children. At the age of 46, she went back to school and got her last degree at the age of 58. She moved later in her life to Arizona and worked with the Gila River Indian community, and it became clear that her aunt that she was with had significant memory loss. Judith gave up her job in Arizona and returned to Indiana to take care of her aunt. Give it up for Judith DeLore from the Priscilla Project.
The Priscilla Project is a medication dispensing device that dispenses medication according to how it's prescribed by your doctors. It is interconnected with other technologies such as cell phones, tablets, and stuff. But not only that, it'll be interconnected with the healthcare community as well. Your family physician and anybody else that needs the information about your medical care. This is to help for more informed decision making on the part of health caregivers like your doctor, yourself, and if you're taking care of somebody else. I am currently working with the NIC, the Northeast Indiana Innovation Center, WEOC, the Women's Opportunity, the Women's Entrepreneurial Opportunity Center, the Fortitude Fund in Innovate Northeast Indiana. I've had initial discussions with Dr. Miro and Parkview. I have applied for the Parkview Innovation Program. So all of this will stay local. This will help locally. It will expand beyond local, but it will start here as well. And this all came about because, as I said, I gave up warm winters in Arizona to come back to winters in northern Indiana to take care of my aunt. I'm a very dedicated niece. So, because she has dementia, the first 3 weeks I was there, I watched her take her medication twice. It was thyroid medicine. I couldn't stop her. And she also passed out on me. I mean, cold, passed out. That was a fun 911 call. She woke, when she came to, her vitals were better than mine, so that's a mystery. We needed a solution. Immediately, I took her medications away and started giving them to herself. This woman was such a caring woman, she was awarded the Sagamore of the Wabash. She did not treat me like that caring woman. When I took her medication away, she was very combative. So, we needed a different solution, and I found PillPack online, which is a type of packaging for medications. It didn't work because it was not locked and secure. This device that I'm developing now is locked, it's secure, and it will also give information to those that need it. My aunt, in all her dementia, understands what the device does, and she has agreed to use it. Well, whether she does or not, we will see. But this device will not only just help my aunt, it will help me because I manage multiple medications, mine as well as my aunt's. So families that have, you know, fathers, mothers, grandparents, children with autism and different health issues that need to be taken care of, this will help them. It will help in the CAS house as well because they can help manage medications for multiple individuals. There are an unlimited number of things that this thing will be able to do as far as managing medications. And it will also collect information that will be helpful too. It will be interconnected. I'm also involved with the Internet of Things that Nick has just started too, that has been awarded a grant. So I will be involved with that so that everything is interconnected. And with Parkview and different organizations such as that, then we can reach a lot of different people and help a lot of different people manage their medications. $290 billion a year is spent on extra visits to the doctor and stuff because medication is mismanaged.
Judith Lurie from the Priscilla Project will now answer some questions for Judith. In prototype development, we do not have production ready. We are working on production ready. I'm working with a local patent attorney too to make sure we do not, because we have some modifications that we've made and design and stuff, and I'm working with that patent attorney to make sure we do not violate any patents out there. And we are currently going towards production ready, hopefully in 2020.
So I have a clarifying question. So the machine both monitors when the medications are released and if somebody's been taking them, and then relays that to the family and the medical practitioners.
Yes, authorized individuals, yes.
Awesome.
Is this going to be able to, like, if someone doesn't want to take their medication?
Yes, it'll record that person refused.
Okay. Will this device be able to be produced locally?
Yes, that's the goal.
How is this device going to function differently than things like Philips medication dispensers that they currently have?
That we are looking into, because I just came across the Philips medication dispenser the last couple weeks. It did not show up on the internet before that. We have a few ideas that will make that different as well. That's why we're in the prototyping and we're talking to patent attorneys as well. So,
can this device also help with things like overdoses for those who may be addicted to certain substances?
Absolutely, absolutely. I didn't even discuss the opioid crisis. If my aunt had been taking opioids instead of the thyroid medicine, I wouldn't even be here because she would be gone and I wouldn't have thought of this.
So what information does the device collect to give to the healthcare providers?
Compliance. Did you take it correctly? Did you take it on time? Did you not take it? Did you refuse? That kind of thing, because when you go to the doctor and you say, well, my medication's not working, the doctor can say, this is why.
So you say it reports all those things, so how does it know if you didn't take it? What stops the patient from
That is part of our unique design that Philips does not have.
Can you tell us about the costs of the machine?
We have not determined that yet, but the idea is to have three different models out there, good, better, and best. So the good will be affordable with the lowest profit margin, and then you'll have the better, which has more features, kind of like your minivans, and then you'll have the luxury models too, with all the bells and whistles.
Who will be responsible for filling the device?
It will be, the medication comes pre-packaged, so all you have to do is drop and load. And you can have a pharmacist do that if you want.
We have any more questions? We have 30 more seconds. All right. Give it up for Judith Lurie from the Priscilla Project. It takes a lot to come up here and talk for 4 minutes. Can we give it up for all the presenters that came up here tonight? The
best part of the night will be now we get to eat. So we're gonna, somebody's excited. So we're gonna have dinner now. I wanna thank the people that provided the dinner, Janie and Andrew from the soup staff. Yeah, go ahead and give it up for them. So during dinner, please feel free to discuss all the presentations, talk it out. There's information on your tables about the presentation to help jog your memory. There's the bios right there. And you can place your vote by filling out your ballot and placing it on the pots on the stage right here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we'll get started with dinner right now, and we will begin tallying the votes at 7:30, and I'll come back on here and remind you guys of some things. So go ahead and we'll start dinner. All right, as you guys are grabbing your dinner, don't forget to get, get the post-it notes on your table, and if you have any suggestions, you can put them in those squares on that back wall. So any suggestions, write them on those post-it notes and put them in those squares on that back wall. As well as the surveys on the table. Please fill out those surveys and turn them in on the table. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay, good. You guys are like, I want to get my dinner. Right now I want to welcome to the stage Aaron Robles. He has presented in the past, and he's going to give us an update on his project. Welcome, Aaron.
Hello, how is everybody doing? Everybody paying attention to me? Steve Franks? I see him ignoring me up there. Well, calling you out. My name is Aaron Robles, and I am the founder of FounderSpark. For those of you who don't know what FounderSpark is, we are an organization dedicated to helping people start businesses. We do that right now through monthly events as well as some other events where we're building a community. So like-minded people who want to help each other out, that's what we're all about. It started just from my experience being an immigrant, being a DACA recipient, and having to become an entrepreneur by force. So I want to give you guys a little bit of an update from when we presented to now. As of this year, out of all the events, all but one have completely sold out. So attendance is up. And I love seeing people here at Soup. Yeah, thank you. We have some people that come see us for the first time. And to give you a little touch on origins, we interview people that are entrepreneurs in our community. We've had people talk about divorce. We've had people talk about suicide. We've had people talk about all the real stuff that happens when you start a business, because we know it doesn't stop just because you started a business, right? Some of you guys know that. So to give you guys some update, we've been able to kind of expand what we do. This year was the first year that we did Blaze. It was a pitch competition. Some of you may have heard about it. But we were really excited because apart from telling the stories of entrepreneurs, we were able to give out some money. So we gave a total of $6,000 in funds for people. So it was really exciting to be able to do something similar to what Soup does and give people actual money to make things happen. In addition to that, first and second place both went and represented Fort Wayne at the 2019 Innovation Showcase in Indianapolis. So we were able to feed local entrepreneurs in Indy and get them introduced into more of a statewide scene. We also did something called Startup Village during Open Streets. We connected people with ESOs, entrepreneurial support organizations. So our friends at Soup were there, Greater Fort Wayne was there, Fortitude Fund, a lot of organizations that help people start businesses. So our goal was to help connect people who want to start a business with the organizations that are there to help them. So exposure for everyone is a good thing for us. We're also happy to announce that we were accepted to Greater Fort Wayne's Bridge Program. We were one of the 15 companies selected to become a mentee, and we had the honor of Parkview Health partnering with us, and they chose us to help us grow into a national company that is located right here in Fort Wayne. You know, our goal is to represent Fort Wayne not only on the state level but on the national level and let them know what Fort Wayne is capable of. So we're really excited for that partnership for the next 5 years. And last but not least, I want to promote our next Origins event. It's going to be October 16th during Startup Week. Startup Week is going to be a whole week of free events meant for entrepreneurs and people who want to get involved in the community. We are going to be interviewing our next entrepreneur.
Barb Backhard from Vera Bradley. We're gonna get her on stage and she's gonna tell us the wild story of how they started Vera Bradley. In addition to that, we're partnering with the Vera Bradley Foundation in honor of Breast Cancer Awareness Month. They're gonna be there and they have some giveaways. We're gonna be raising awareness as well as raising money for their research and for their funding. So not only do you get to hear how Vera Bradley started a multi-million dollar international company, but you'll have the opportunity to learn more about what the foundation is doing and how you can donate. So it's October 16th, you can find it on Facebook. But those are some of the things we've done and we're just getting started. So thank you so much.
Thanks for your update. Give it up for Aaron. Do not forget, we are nearing the end of casting your vote, so you can still vote in these two pots right here. If you haven't done it, go ahead. Right now, I would like to welcome to the stage Lauren Caggiano. She is from Big Brothers Big Sisters, which is an awesome program. I actually am involved in that program and do their lunch buddy program, so it really is awesome. She's a volunteer with Big Brothers and Big Sisters, and she has been with them for 10 years, and she has her current match, Victoria. They just celebrated 7 years together. She enjoys sharing her passion for mentoring with individuals and organizations. Give it up for Lauren.
She passed away 10 years ago last month. It was a very formative experience for me, grieving her loss. I wanted to, I'm sure if anyone has lost someone that was close to them, I wanted to find a way to channel the grief into something positive. And my grandmother was the type of woman that would give you the shirt off her back. So I became acquainted with someone who was involved with Big Brothers Big Sisters, and I respected her. So I thought, you know what, I'll give it a shot. So I started off in the Lunch Buddies program, which is a program where you go into the school system 1 hour a week during the school year, and I was hooked. And then from there, I did the community-based, which means I was able to pick up my match, take her to, you know, Pizza Hut, movies, whatever. And then, unfortunately, with that young girl, things didn't work out with her family situation, so I was matched with my current match of 7 years, so wait for it, Victoria. So around the first of the year, Big Brothers unveiled their new brands, and so we are defenders of potential. So what does that mean? You know, we are not saviors, we are not, you know, we're just helping kids rise to their level. So basically, my challenge to you is think about, do you have 1 hour in your week, you know, that you're watching Netflix? Heck, even if you're going grocery shopping, I say to people, that is an activity that you could bring a young person along with, right? So being a mentor is not this lofty experience. It's really something that is accessible, and encourage everyone to consider it. There's really two opportunities at the moment. There's the Lunch Buddies program that I mentioned, where you go into the school, can be near your workplace or your home, and then there's the community-based, where that is where you take the individual to various places. So different ways of getting involved. We also need people to help out at events and fundraisers and that. So that said, if you have questions, I will be at the table in the back. I would love to answer your burning questions. So, thank you so much.
Give it up for Lauren for Big Brothers Big Sisters. I have two mics now. There we go. All right, you guys literally have 1 minute, like 60 seconds, to get your votes right here if you haven't got them in. Just so you guys are aware, again, the post-it notes at your table, you can put suggestions on those squares in the back wall. So you see purple, red, green, pink, orange. You can put your post-it note suggestions back on those squares. And we have like 15 seconds. And the pots are leaving the stage. So finish up with your dinner and we will resume in, I think it's 7:35. So we are gonna start at 7:45 in just 10 minutes, if I'm correct. And we're gonna announce a winner. This is exciting. So finish up your dinner and we will resume in just 10 minutes.